Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Donna Mineo. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
And here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dallas Teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now you can also send us your questions on our website. Go to homeworkhotline.org, click on the Yak Back button, and send in your question. Okay, it's Tuesday.
Yes, it is.
And that means it's time for our creature teaser.
This creature has prickly spines all over its body except its belly, legs, and face. To protect itself from predators, it curls into a tight ball to hide its spineless parts. When it is born, this mammal's spines are soft and short, but soon after birth, they lengthen and become sharp and stiff. After 3 weeks, it is ready to leave the nest to hunt with mom.
Now, this carnivore's eyesight is weak, so it relies on its senses of hearing and smell to move around to find food. It eats smaller creatures, including insects, lizards, mice, and frogs, and some people keep these mammals as pets and use them to prey on the common garden pests.
If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
But every correct response will add to our Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you could win a tablet at the end of the season. Now, if I remember correctly, I think we had one of these guys on a couple years ago on a Tuesday.
Maybe.
Yeah.
All right, I believe we have someone on for homework. Ariana, is that you?
Yeah.
Hello, Ariana.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. I'm going to walk to the board, and while I'm doing that, could you tell me what we're going to be working on?
Joshua delivered 30 hives to the local fruit farm, and if the farmer has paid to use 5% of the total number of Joshua's hives, how many hives does Joshua have in all?
All right, so it sort of looks like you might be working on equivalent fractions?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's first look at 5%. How can I write that as a fraction?
5 over 100.
5 over 100, excellent. So I have 5% of the hives, right?
Yeah.
So 5% of some number is going to give me 30, right?
Yeah.
So if I set this equal, how would I write 30 as a fraction?
30 over, and then it'd be blank.
It'd be blank because it's 30 over 1, but we don't have to write that 30 because we actually have to find how many of them. Are you using variables?
No.
Okay, well, I filled it in with an X, which is like a blank for you, okay?
Right.
So I'll just erase that so that we'll put like one of those square blanks.
Okay.
Okay? So now how would you solve equivalent fractions? What would you do?
You'd have to find out how many, in this case it'd be the five, how many times it could go into 30.
And do you know that answer?
It would be times six.
Okay, so 5 times 6 is going to give me the 30. So what do I have to do with the 100 now?
Would you multiply it by 6?
Yes, because when you're dealing with fractions, what you do to the top, you have to do to the bottom. It keeps it equal, okay? So now what's 100 times 6?
It would be 600.
It is 600. All right, so now let's figure out what these numbers all mean. The 5 over the 100 was 5%, right? The
yes.
30 was the number of hives you delivered, correct?
Yeah.
And we had to figure out that 30 was 5% of some big number. So how many hives total does he have?
600.
600 hives. So we have 600 hives to be that at the farm, okay? And he took 30 of those.
Okay.
All right. So can you review real quick what you did for me? You took a fraction.
And I multiplied it, like I multiplied the 5 by 6 to get 30.
Yep.
And I took 100 and multiplied it by 6 because whatever I do to the top, I have to do the bottom.
Yep.
And I got 600.
That's excellent. So you just remember, because you were a little questionable about what to do on the bottom. Whatever you do to the top, you have to do to the bottom. Okay, Ariana?
Okay.
All right. Thank you for calling, and thank you for a great problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, we have Deer on the line. Hello, Deer. Hello. Hello. Oh, we had Deer on the line. Are you there? All right. Maybe we maybe we'll get his call, and I'll try to work it out anyway. All right. All right. 4 3/4 divided by 7/8. Okay. Hopefully you're still watching. Sorry if we lost you there. All right. What we have is a mixed number divided by a fraction. And in order to do that, we have to change our mixed number back to an improper fraction first. We got to have two fractions. So to do that, we're going to keep the denominator, which is 4, multiply the denominator by our whole number. 4 times 4 gives us 16, and then add in our numerator, which will give us 19. All right? Divided by 7/8. Now we can treat it just like any division of fractions, which tells us that we're going to, some people say keep change, but what we're going to do is change our division to multiplication and use the reciprocal of the 7/8. Okay. Deer, are you there now?
Yeah.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Okay, sorry we missed you there. Let's go back. This was your problem, was 4 3/4 divided by 7/8, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And what I had said was, to work this out, the first thing we need to do is change that mixed number here, the 4 3/4, into an improper fraction, okay?
Okay.
All right. Now to do that, we keep the common, we keep that denominator, right?
Yep.
And we multiply the denominator times the whole number. So 4 times 4 was?
16.
Good. Plus the 3 in the numerator gave me?
19.
Okay, so very good. So we have 19 over 4 now divided by 7/8, right?
Yeah.
Okay, now what's the rule when we're dividing fractions? What do we have to do?
That you have to find the reciprocal of the second number. Of the split multiply.
You got it. Very good. So we're going to keep it 19 over 4 for our first fraction, right? I heard you say change to multiply. And what does it mean when we do a reciprocal?
We flip the second fraction.
We flip the second one. So the 8 becomes the numerator and the 7 becomes our denominator. Okay? Now, have you been taught how to cancel before we do our multiplication?
Like to simplify?
Yes. Can we do it right here? Okay?
Yeah. 8 goes into 4 twice, and 4 divided by 4 is 1.
Okay, good. So, yes, 4 goes into 8 twice.
Yeah.
And 4 divided by 4 is 1. Now, can we do anything over here?
No.
No, we have two prime numbers there, don't we?
Yeah.
Nope, so there's nothing we can do. But that made it a little bit easier for us. And now what's the rule for multiplying fractions?
We multiply now.
Yes, right. And we're going to multiply numerator times numerator, right?
Yeah.
All right.
36.
What's that now?
No, 38.
Sorry. 38, very good. Okay, so 38. 2 times 19 is 38. And 1 times 7 would be?
7.
Are we done?
No.
We're going to need to change that improper fraction back to a mixed number again, aren't we?
Yeah.
Tell me what
seven,
I need.
7 goes into 5 times.
You got it. 5 times, so that's going to be our whole number, right?
Yeah.
All right. How many left over?
Three.
So that becomes our numerator, right?
Yeah.
And we keep the same denominator. And so 38 sevenths is the same as five.
5 and 3/7.
5 3/7. Very good. All right, you did a nice job on that. Sorry we missed you at the beginning, but you came back on and you did great.
Okay.
All right, thanks for calling. Bye now.
I said, hey, hey.
When multiplying fractions, begin by multiplying the numerators of the fraction, and then multiplying the denominators of the fraction.
All right, tonight we're going to head to the Buffalo Zoo to learn about the solitary animal that lives in the colder regions in Russia. Check it out.
We have two Siberian tigers here at the Buffalo Zoo. They're more commonly known as Siberian tigers, but now they're also known as Amur tigers because they live near the Amur River in Russia. There's actually 8 different types of tigers in the world, 3 of which are extinct. And here at the Buffalo Zoo, we have Siberian tigers and a Bengal tiger. And our Bengal tiger is actually a golden Bengal tiger, and it's very rare. There's about 50 of them in captivity. It's actually a genetic mutation just for a color variation. The Siberian tigers are one of the big cat species. Cats are divided into groups, big cats and small cats. The big cats is tigers, jaguars, and leopards. And big cats are called big cats because they have a flexible hyoid bone in their throat that gives them the ability to roar. And small cats have less flexible bone, so they can only purr. Tigers have stripes on their sides and spots on their ears to help them blend into their environment so they can ambush their prey. The spots on the back of their ears are called eye spots, and a lot of animals have those. It's to confuse their prey species to thinking they're looking one way when they're actually looking another way. Siberian tigers have very powerful legs, and they can leap in excess of 8 to 10 meters. They also hunt at night, mostly by ambush, and are only successful in 1 to 20 of their attempts. Siberian tigers are biologically adapted to live in the cold. They have a little thicker fur than the other tiger species, and it's a little thicker on their paws. Siberian tigers they're acclimated to our summers in Buffalo, so they can live in warmer temperatures, but actually in Russia it gets very cold, up to minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Tigers are usually found solitary. Sometimes in the wild you'll find a female and her young together, but other than that they're usually a solitary species. Here at the Buffalo Zoo, you might see various objects in some of the animal enclosures. Sometimes you'll see big plastic barrels or traffic cones, and it's what we call enrichment, and we give it to the animals every day. It's a very important part of trying to encourage natural behaviors and playtime among our animals. All species of tigers right now are currently endangered, and most of that is through habitat loss and through hunting for poaching, and in Asia, a lot of times they sell body parts of tigers for Chinese medicine.
I often wondered why they had spots.
Oh, okay. That's like they said, common in a lot of the animals.
Yeah.
You know what I thought? It was kind of, I remember growing up, we were taught that the lions were the kings of the jungles.
Yes. Yeah,
but tigers are actually larger, and
they are larger.
Yeah.
Yep, oh, wow.
When they're solitary, so they're hunting alone, not in a group like the lions usually are. So it's kind of cool. And I just noticed even in that picture we had in the enclosure there, that it really blended in. You'd think
yeah,
those stripes are so distinctive, you think it'd make them easy to see, but it really did cause them to blend in there, so.
Yeah, I find it interesting that they're solo animals, that they don't go around with a lot of other animals. Like, mm-hmm. you see herds of other things going through in different deserts and just mm-hmm. even up in Montana and things like that when you see the mountain lions.
Yeah.
But it's kind of
interesting. Well, I guess that's part of the reason why they're so endangered, because being solitary, they need a large area, a large habitat area, each one, and so they're particularly vulnerable to loss of habitat.
Yeah.
Very cool.
So want to know more about this animal and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right. I think we have another call.
I believe we do.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Is this Aaliyah?
Yes.
Hello, Aaliyah.
Okay, Aaliyah, what are we going to work on tonight?
Okay, we're going to work on time.
Okay, I'm going to go to the board, and you can read me your problem.
Okay.
All right, Aaliyah, I'm all ready. Would you like to read it to me?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay, 10 times 3.
Okay.
Plus.
10 plus, 10 times 3 plus?
And there's one of those like,
is it called a parenthesis?
Parenthesis.
Okay. Parenthesis, go ahead.
1.
Okay.
Times.
Gotcha.
And then there's like a blank. There's like a blank right there.
Okay. And did you end your parentheses?
Yes.
All right. So you have a question that says 10 times 3 plus parentheses 1 times blank. And what do we have to find for the blank, honey?
I think we might have to separate the 3 or something.
Okay. Is this supposed to be an equals instead of a plus?
Yes. Yes, yes. No, it was a plus, but 10 times 3 equals in a parenthesis.
10 times 3 equals.
In a parenthesis.
Yep.
And then 1 times blank.
All right. Now, so do you know what 10 times 3 is?
Yes.
What is it?
30.
30. So, if all you're going to do is convert it into 1 times something, what would that number have to be? 1 times what gives you 30, honey?
Yes.
What number do I have to put? 1 times what? 30.
1 times 30
gives you 30, right?
Okay.
All right. Now, when you called in earlier, I think you had 3 times 10 is equal to, and then in parentheses, 2 times 10 plus something?
No.
No?
No.
Okay. All right. I just wanted to make sure that we didn't have the wrong problem on the board for you.
Okay.
You can work out the rest of your questions and call Dial-A-Teacher back, and they will help you and make sure you have them all correct, okay?
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Looking for an easy way to remember all 5 Great Lakes? Just think of homes. Huron, Ontario, Michigan, Erie, Superior.
Okay, we have Anthony.
Yes,
hello, Anthony.
Hello.
How are you today?
Good, how are you?
Good, but I understand you have a math question for me.
Yes.
All right, what is it we're working on, Anthony?
Put the volume down. Okay, I put the volume down.
Thank you.
Okay, so the problem, mm-hmm. Can I read the problem?
Yes, please.
Okay, it says 3 over 8.
Okay.
Minus racket. Parenthesis, 1 plus 1.
1 plus 1?
Yeah.
Okay.
And 1 over 8, with the 1 and 1 and 1 over 8.
Okay, 1 plus 1 and 1 over 8?
Yeah. Okay. No, 1 plus 1 and 1 over 8, yeah.
Okay. And am I closing my parentheses?
And parentheses, yeah.
Okay.
Close it.
Yeah, all right.
Minus 7 over 8.
Okay.
Times 2. And racket.
Okay, and then close my bracket?
Yeah, close. Let me see. Close.
Okay.
It.
So you're doing some order of operations here, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yes, and what does that tell us that we always have to do first?
We have to multiply add the parentheses first.
Okay, we've got to work what's in the parentheses, and we actually have a bracket and a set of parentheses, right?
Yeah.
And so the rule is we got to start with the inside one first, don't we? Because those brackets actually are
the
like
inside.
Parentheses. Yes.
Yeah, then the outside.
Very good. And I heard you say we've got to add first. So what's 1
yeah,
plus,
add.
What's gonna be 1 plus 1 over 1 and 1 8?
1 plus 1 equals 2.
Yeah.
And 1 over 8.
Right. So that one's fairly simple. We can just add those numbers. So let me do next thing is 7 eighths times two. This is still in this parentheses, right? And we have 3/8 minus. Okay, what would we have to do next?
You would have to subtract.
Well, no, actually, we still got to work with our parentheses. So we have to solve what's in our parentheses first, right?
Oh, yes.
And
so
you
only
said
the, 7/8 times 2.
Right, we have to multiply before. Okay, all right. So that 2 could be 2/1, right?
Yeah.
That's a whole number. And so what's 2 times 7?
2 times 7 equals 14.
Good. And 1 times 8 would be 8, right?
2 times 8, yeah.
Okay, actually 1 times 8. Because remember now, we have 1 in our denominator here, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Well, since that's 14/8 is an improper fraction, you have to see how many times 8 would go into 14.
Okay, we could do that. The other thing we could do is we could change what we have here into an improper fraction, because we're going to need to subtract here anyway. And notice we do have a common denominator, don't we?
Yeah.
Yep. Which way do we want to do it?
The way you said.
All right. So tell me, how am I going to change 2 1/8 to a fraction?
By doing the whole number times the numerator.
Whole number times the denominator.
So, a denominator, yes.
Yes. What's 2 times 8?
16.
Good. Plus the one that's in the numerator would be? 17,
wait,
right?
8 times 2 is 16, plus the 17.
Yeah, 17. What's my denominator going to be?
Denominator is going to be 17. Oh, no. Denominator is going to be...
Still going to be 8, right? We keep the same denominator?
8, yeah.
Yes.
Because
okay.
It's going to...
Okay, now we've got something a little bit easier to work with. We've got 17/8 minus 14/8, right?
Yes.
Tell me, what do we need to do here?
We would need to, do 17 minus 14.
Good. 17 minus 14 is going to give me what?
17 minus 14.
Would give us the 3, right?
Yeah.
Yep. And we keep our common denominator, so it gives us 3/8, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now we have a fairly simple problem, because what's 3/8 minus 3/8 going to give us?
0.
0, right. Okay, anything minus itself would be 0. So let's go back and look quick.
The answer would be 0 then?
The answer is going to be 0. Now let's go back and look what we did. When we had our original problem, okay, because this is PEMDAS, order of operations, we knew we had to solve what's in our parentheses first. We had to start with the inner parentheses, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so we solved our inner parentheses, got 2 1/8. The next thing we have to do, because we're still working within the parentheses, is the multiplication here. So we multiplied 2 times 7/8 and got our 14/8, right?
Yes.
We still got to solve what's in our parentheses. So we solved that and got 3/8. And so 3/8 minus 3/8 gave us the 0. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Nice job. You did a great job.
That's it. Also, the answer then would be 0, right?
The answer is just 0, Anthony. Nice job.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for calling. I said, hey,
hey. The order to solve a long division problem is divide, multiply, subtract, bring down. You can remember this order with a family: dad, mom, sister, brother.
We have a winner in tonight's creature teaser. Sean, are you up there?
Yeah.
Hi, Sean. What's our answer?
Hedgehog.
Hedgehog. Very good.
What clues did we give that told you that?
It has a spiky thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. When I first started hearing, I was thinking porcupine, but it wasn't a porcupine, was it?
No.
No, very good, Sean.
You say it was a porcupine.
Yeah. It was a hedgehog. You were right. It was a porcupine. Well, very good. I hope your teacher's watching and gives you extra credit for that, Sean. Now, what grade are you in?
7th grade.
7th grade?
Good job.
Very good.
Good job.
All right.
Hey, did you know that they only weigh about 14 to 39 ounces? So they're tiny.
Yeah, they're not very big.
They're like a little pet.
Yeah.
Yeah, they'd be about the size of a mouse, I think, if they're 14 ounces.
A little bit bigger, but yeah, they're not very big. Well, okay, hope you take care of that cough, Sean, and congratulations, but don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
All right, now tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll find out what the Young Entrepreneurs Academy is and what makes it so unique.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.